hands are swinging the opposite of our legs, they might be out of sync. So let your arms rest completely on your side, and in order to remind you, if you're carrying something, if you start swinging your arms, you're going to feel it right away. It'll remind you, because you're going to be doing this subconsciously for a long, long time until you break the synapse that is telling you to use your arms in relation to your legs. Leg moves forward, arm moves backward. Your soul, we've been doing that for how long? We need to break that so our arms can move independently. Also, when we're serving as guardians and we have something to carry, we don't have our arms to swing. So our walking gait becomes awkward because we're so used to this reverse rhythm. We can break it, our arms can function independently of our legs, which opens us up to options. Let's say I have something to carry. I have two things to carry. I can carry them very well if I'm coming from my core and my center right here and I'm keeping balance. And that means my hips are going to be kept looser than I would typically walk because I'm not relying on my arms. So when I step forward with one foot, the other hip is going to come forward to counteract it. It's just these things that I'm describing are going to happen naturally. If you just relax and work to forget about what you've learned about walking and stay off the trail, you're going to start doing just what I'm describing. It's going to happen naturally. I wouldn't worry about whether you're coming down on the ball of your foot or the heel of your foot or the right side or the left side, because you're going to be coming down all different ways, as I've already mentioned. Typically, you're going to be more on the ball of your foot than on the heel of your foot because of the way the terrain lays. It also gives you an extra joint. When you come down on your heel, your knee is the only joint that can absorb shock. If you come down on the ball of your foot, you've got two joints here that can move and absorb shock. That allows you to be more flexible when you're going up and down and over contours. And also, if you're running, when you come down on the ball of your foot, it helps keep shin splints from happening, keeps you from hurting your ankle, keeps the shock from going up your spine, and it allows you to be more flexible in terms of moving, turning corners and such. You can do that a lot easier off the ball of your foot than you can off of your heel. Is this all making sense?
Mm-hmm.
You can stop me whenever you want if you want a deeper explanation of what I'm talking about. Again, I'm not giving this just for you to memorize it and expect you to walk this way, because you're going to be learning this. What I really want to stress is for you to unlearn what you've already learned about walking, so that you're free to learn how to do it naturally. When we walk in a city, we generally walk with we throw our foot out and we stiffen up our knee, come down like this, shock on the heel. Here, you're going to, if you're going to be walking comfortably and running comfortably, you're going to be keeping your knees a little bit bent. It's going to happen naturally. That helps you to go up and down and over things. If you're stiff, if you come down to the stiff leg, all you can do is go down. You can't go up. You can only go in one direction. If your knee is bent, you can go either up or down a little bit to adjust. See the difference? It's like a built-in shock absorber. It makes a big difference in comfort and also in speed and dexterity. Well, a few exercises that'll help you to break old routines. When we start walking, we typically, because we walk like this, we need to lean into our walk before we hit the ground. So usually the upper torso is moving before we move the leg. The way you're going to be learning to walk here, you're going to be extending your foot first. You're not going to commit yourself to your step because you don't know what the next step's going to be. It depends upon how the terrain goes. So you're going to be walking more bent-legged. You're going to be walking with probably smaller steps, because when you don't have your legs stiff, you cannot take as long a step. Also, when you have your legs stiff and you're leaning into the step, you've already committed yourself. You can't stop. If you see something there that you don't want to step on, it's too late. But if you're relaxed and bent-kneed, you can put your foot out and, oh, I don't want to step there. You step over a little bit. You keep adjusting as you go. Every step is different. best way of walking if you want to do that. A couple of exercises that will help you to maintain your balance in your torso is that whenever you're standing around, stand on one leg instead of two. Keep this knee bent a little bit. You can do whatever you want with this leg. A good thing to do is to pull it out one side, pull it on the other side, tuck it behind you. It makes it more difficult if you tuck it behind you because you're not relying on this leg to catch you after you're standing for a while. Stand for a while until it hurts. Go down, up, open the ball of your foot, come down, just vary it all you want. Squats are good, good exercise if you're standing around too. Squat, you can squat on one leg all the better, squat on one leg and on the other leg. When you're sitting around talking like this, vary between squatting like this, sitting cross-legged. Sitting cross-legged works very well because it's stretching out your tendons. Practice giving up on one leg instead of two, and practice squatting again.
I have a question about that. Mm-hmm. Does it matter if you squat on your toes or on your heels?
I would do both. Vary it. Okay, while you're moving, practice. We tend to do extremes when we're walking in the city. We don't need to worry about tripping very often unless we're coming to a curb or a crack in the sidewalk. Don't have to look down very much. Don't have to lift your feet. When you're walking here, there's a whole lot to observe, a whole lot to notice. You want to look ahead, of course, because you want to know where you're going. You might want to stay on course. You want to observe your surroundings. You want to pick up any sign you're seeing. So you may not be looking on the ground all the time. If you are, you're going to be missing everything else. So what I do is I vary the amount of times I'm looking downward with the difficulty of the terrain, the difficulty of moving through the terrain. Here it's pretty smooth. I might be stepping over a little something or other here and there. I won't look down very often, maybe once every 8 or 10 paces. What you're doing, if you're not looking down all the time, is you're training your photographic memory. When you look down, you get an impression of what's there, and look up, and rely upon what you've seen. And you're going to get better and better and better at it, so that you can keep your sight available for noticing other things. Is that clear enough to everybody? Mm-hmm. So what's going to happen is that you're automatically going to be glancing down more often the rougher the terrain. The easier the terrain, the less often you're going to be glancing down. What I'd like to suggest, before you even think about running, is to just practice walking and start slowly. And we're going to do some walking exercises very shortly here. Because running is just fast walking, and if we can take it easy, take it slow, to work to break our old patterns, and then just gradually increase our speed as we feel comfortable without pushing ourselves. Just gradually increase our speed as we gain the dexterity and flexibility, and our old patterns start to shed. We're not going to be naturally running the same way we walk. We're going to be running very gracefully. When you're going through, it doesn't matter, any terrain, work to not touch anything, to not have your body touch anything. If you're coming up through this, for example, slide through sideways so you don't touch anything. Step over this, step around this. The less you can touch, the more attuned you are, the more aware you are of your surroundings, and the less disturbance you're going to make. Every time you touch and brush on something, you're sending out a shockwave, sound wave, or a vibration wave that puts something on the ground that's alerting the animals around you. This is one big aspect of invisibility. You know, invisibility is not being seen. It's not disappearing. It's just not being seen, not being noticed. If I'm standing here and nobody sees me, it doesn't matter if I'm invisible or not. In all effect, I am invisible. So, going through the woods, if there's a bunch of brush right here, rather than plowing through, as most of us did when we were walking through, duck underneath. Get down on all fours if you need to, or just touch down with a couple of fingers to hold your balance while you're getting up. Move around things, through things, under things. Just be as sinuous as possible. It's great natural yoga. If you move like this, if you grew up like this, you would never have to do any sort of a movement exercise, whether it be yoga or anything else. You would be naturally limber and flexible. Just a way of being. And that's why we've invented all these exercises, because we're not that way. We need to constantly work back to the way we could potentially be. We're going to learn something different here.
So when I'm walking in the woods, I'm not really consciously thinking, oh, right now I should put my feet here, or I should be relaxing or tensing this or that muscle, and just let it happen.
Eventually, if you're not thinking about what you're doing now, if you're not conscious, you're going to be walking the same way you walked in the city, which means you're going to be shuffling your feet, you're going to be tripping on things, you're going to be ground through brush. But that's the ideal. Eventually, you won't be thinking about it at all. It'll just come naturally. Again, we have to break the synapses that tell us how to walk. If you notice that you're walking along and your foot keeps catching on things, see, the wider our straddle, the more we're going to be catching on things, the wider a trail we need. The narrower our straddle, the narrower our trail, and the less opportunity there is for us to trip on something and catch something. It's just naturally going to happen. If I am duck-footed, all of a sudden my trail is that much wider. It's as wide as I turn my foot. I have much more potential for catching on things. If I'm not duck-footed or pigeon-toed, if I'm coming straight ahead, I'm sliding very sinuously through the brush. It's just the natural way to be. And that'll come if I'm conscious about what I'm doing. If I'm not, I'm going to keep walking like this and brushing things and tripping things and creating concentric rings.
You're not so concerned about necessarily how you hold your back or your neck or your pelvis?
If you're loose, it's going to happen that your spine is just going to have a natural curvature, because if you have your hips thrown forward, you're straightening out your spine and it doesn't have much limberness, it doesn't have much flexibility. You want your spine to be nice and flexible, your hips to be flexible. The spine has a natural curve, less curve, so that it's all sharp.
What about the neck?
Your head moves independently too, just like your arms.
Are you discouraging running completely?
No, in fact, what I'd like to suggest is if you're on the trail going out for a drink or something, or right around camp, that you skip instead of running. The reason is that when you skip, when you're pushing off, you're up on, naturally up on the balls of your feet. Does everyone know what skipping is?
No.
I'd like to demonstrate.
That's right.
Yeah, see how he's up on the balls of his feet pushing off? Double step. You've all done skipping, I'm sure. It puts some good pressure on your calves. It helps you develop your calves, which you're going to need a lot when you're walking out in the natural environments where your push-off power comes almost entirely from your calves. And your calves are what operate this joint right here. So the stronger your calves, the easier you're going to get around. And skipping is a great exercise for it. So, skip rather than run.
Looks happier anyway.
Whether you're happy or not, right?
Right.
Create illusions. Another good training is to wolf walk, which is to walk in the footsteps of the person behind you, not just in the literal footsteps, but to move as they move, to go where they're going, so that what we're going to look like is the vertebrae of a snake, you know, the way a snake moves. You know, the body just follows the head wherever the head goes. We're going to move like a snake through the terrain here. Stay about depending on how fast we go, if we're walking, we only need to stay about 2 paces behind the person in front of us so that we're not bumping into them, stops. Which is good training also, by the way. Do that every once in a while. Just stop right there. And the whole line should just be able to stop instantly. If someone before you is just making too many mistakes, you know, if they're tripping and stumbling and such, correct it so that people behind you can pick up on your correction. The faster we move when we're wolf walking, the more distance we move between each other. It's good awareness training too, because I'm not only taking care of myself, it's circle consciousness again. We're starting to move as one animal, as organs within an organism. Okay, let's do some walking. You want to grab something to put in your hands, unless you have something already. That I'd like to share before before I ask how it's going. There's a saying in guardian training, and that is to train like a cat and move as a bear. You know how cats move. If they come up to a fallen log, they don't hop on top of the log and walk on top of it. A bear isn't. A bear is either going to go underneath it or go around it. Bears are not going to go where cats go. Now, for training, it's very important to be cat-like so that we can adapt and adjust to any situation that comes up. However, when we're on a guardian mission, we don't want to take any risks. When we're jumping up on something, we're exposing ourselves. We're also risking, if we're moving fast, we're risking twisting an ankle or falling, breaking an arm, disrupting our movement. So we want to be as quiet and stealthy as possible. The bears and cats are both stealthy, but they're stealthy in different ways. So we want to move like a bear when we're on a guardian mission.
So does that mean in training we train like a cat, like we balance something? Mm-hmm. But in a mission we are as a bear?
Yes. A bear takes a lot fewer chances than a cat. When we move like a bear, we can move more quietly, more invisibly. When you come to something, some obstacle, you know, there's an obstacle right here, and coming up to it, instead of leaning backward and going under it, always lean forward, almost always lean forward. There are exceptions. When I lean forward, I'm maintaining my center, I'm maintaining my balance. If I lean backward, I'm off balance. I can't recover very well if I'm leaning backward. Now I'm going way down under something. I want to flatten out. Notice how a frog has legs off to the side, rear legs, front legs are out like this. When you come up to something, instead of going down like this to crawl under, literally flatten out, throw your legs out to the side, and put your arms out to the side too, so you can flatten down as much as possible and work your way through. That make sense to everybody?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You can get down to the width of, or the height the depth of your head. Actually, if you turn your head sideways, you can get down to the head of your torso here. Your hips right here, those are the widest parts of your body. Your feet are out sideways so that they're not catching anything. You don't have them up. Everything is flat as possible to slide under things. So when we're moving from here on, if you can incorporate those things too, if you come to a log that's a solid log, to hop up on it, balance on it, walk on it, lean forward when you go under things, not way forward, but lean forward just so that you keep your center of gravity, and flatten out when you crawl under things. It's an additional challenge with things in your hands, of course. Black britches. Keep your butt down and move sideways with your hips like this. Alex, get out with your arms. You shouldn't have anything underneath anything. Yeah. Get your arms up, man. Just flatten out. Yeah, get your head down. There you go. Hug the ground, seriously. Yeah, get way down there. Go slowly, you're going too fast. Yeah, that's it. Okay.
I crawl under you. Yeah.
Oh, that's sweet. It's like mating frogs, doesn't it? You can't spread out. You're tight. You're connected like this. You're just down there. You can't spread your legs out. Now you've got to move with your hips. See, I'm moving mostly with my hips and arms. And the more space you have, the more you can spread out and start using your legs as well. Your elbows. See, here I'm catching with my elbows instead of my hands. But you can move entirely without your hands just by moving your hips. Try that. Imagine you're going through a really tight spot. Get as much energy into your hips as possible. You touch with one hip down, and the other hip down, one hip down. Yeah. Okay, I'm gonna check out each one of you. Okay, dig your hips in more, you'll get some more traction. Yeah. Okay. You can use your elbows a bit too.
We can use our shoulders as well, right?
That'll get you through. We need bigger hips. Okay.
Yeah. Looking pretty good.
When you're moving, typically, rather than stepping, say this is the log that over the mountain was leaning against. If you're coming up against a log like that, rather than stepping on it, step over it. Whenever you step on something, you're incurring the risk of making noise. If it's a rotten log, your foot might go through it. If you slip on it, you're going to make some noise. If you're stepping up on a log, you're going to be going like this instead of going sinuously over it. So step over as much as you can rather than stepping on things. Also, if you get into the habit of stepping over things, you're not going to be risking twisting your ankle if you slip for no reason. Okay, how did your exercise go so far? What are you picking up?
It was interesting to see while I was walking, then something was changed and I was kind of know which person was in front. Like, when we start to get in these thin trees, thin small trees, I knew this person was in front, because I don't know, I was just, it was just like only this person would choose such a way, because he's kind of agile enough, flexible enough to move. Then we moved into the other way, like it was really small, it was flat, not high, but flat. Mm-hmm. And I knew it must be this person which must be on top, because this person was behind me. Mm-hmm. So it must be a small person. Mm-hmm. I think that there are group consciousness is asked for that as well. Like choosing the way of knowing everybody is able to walk.
I often underestimated the size of my body. Like I would think that I could make it through a certain area without touching anything. I noticed people stepping on small trees and branches, and I did too. I heard noises under my feet and behind me. But it was very engaging and very interesting.
Any more observations?
For a short moment, I had the feeling that I was sliding through the landscape, but it was hard to wolf walk at the same time, because I was pulling more my own rhythm at that point.
Imagine having that feeling all the time. It's been fun. Why don't we go again and slow it up this time? You can even slow it by half. Just move slowly. And work. As I observed you folks, sometimes I was ahead of you, sometimes off to the side. You were brushing many more branches than I needed to if you were more present with what you were doing. If we slow it up, you'll be able to take your time. We have a couple new techniques now for going under and around things. Use them. Just take your time. Remember, this is nothing about speed. We can go along at a snail's pace, it's fine, it doesn't matter. We're here to attune, to awaken. The pace will just naturally pick up. You're just naturally going to start moving faster as it starts feeling more comfortable. And that's not going to happen this sun. It's going to take a moon or more before you really start moving in the spirit. And the better you can stay present with this stage of the process, the better you're going to be moving later and moving naturally. If you speed it up too much, you're skipping some of the initial training that's needed. You're skipping the breaking of the old patterns and the starting to move unconsciously. You don't want to do that. What the time and energy you're investing now is going to pay off for the rest of your life. So let's do it right. Let's do it fully and completely. Okay, there's another judgment guideline I follow. I always stay out in my frontier. If anything, I'm going to make it more difficult rather than easier. you may find that when you're actually leading a mission, leading is going to be harder than following. You know, more in your mind, more responsibility. And when the going is tough, such as breaking trail through snow, it's going to be more physically exhausting for the first person and for those behind.
I found it hard to concentrate or to stay stay concentrated and giving my best.
That's a great example. That's what I've been waiting for someone to say. Because the concentration is what it takes for the pattern breaking. Later, it's going to be the easiest thing to do to follow the person in front of you. That person is figuring things out for you and you just naturally flow with that person. Right now, it takes concentration. Hard is going to become easy.
Stay
on your edge, keep making it hard. Because that's what you need to break through. There's one rule of trail etiquette, and that is that you do not worry about the person behind you. If you're pushing any branches and you're worried about them flopping back into their faces or whatever, that's entirely their responsibility. If that's happening, they're too close. You have to stay aware and not be concerned about the person behind you. Everybody is responsible for themselves. We have a strong circle again. That's a tough thing to do for people who aren't very flexible. This helps, sitting like this. You can magnify it also by doing this. Get more leverage in there.
And I'm also noticing that my legs are hurting in places I never thought they would hurt before. Mm-hmm. So,
good sign. What you're doing is natural movement here. This is the way our bodies are designed to function. You step over and under and around things. When we do artificially constructed exercises, we're approximating a natural movement. It's not really a natural movement, whether it's yoga or tai chi or qigong or whatever. It's not quite a natural movement. So you're exercising only certain muscles and certain muscle groups. Here, everything is moving. Because no movement is the same movement. You're doing hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different movements instead of the same three or five or one. So you're going to be feeling things you haven't felt before. And that's beautiful. You're starting to fully develop physiologically now. Our muscular system is designed to work together symbiotically. When we do things like push-ups or when we test our strength, we're only testing a few muscles, and that a particular muscle is strong in and of itself. However, when it's working in a symbiotic relationship with the skeletal structure and the other muscles, and we're moving our body in relation to that movement, we have so much more strength, so much more capacity, so much more ability than we know. This is what you're going to be discovering as you develop physically, and as your coordination develops.
And the other thing is from moving. No, like here, it feels like it's getting tighter. I guess that might be normal as well. But just want to mention it.
It's going to feel tighter. What's not used to flexing is going to feel tighter before it feels looser, partially because you're stretching connective tissue and you're going to have some swelling going on around there, so it's going to tighten up. However, through the stretching, once the swelling goes away, it's actually going to be looser and more limber. So you don't want to overdo it, but keep moving. Just keep it moving, keep it limbered up, and you'll find that the reverse is true. Tight is loose. It'll come. Yeah, I remember talking with, this was a long time ago, 30, 35 turns of the seasons ago. I was talking with a very old man. I just moved to this area. And
He was standing a little ways away from me, and he was talking with me, and he asked me what there is between him and me. And I said, there's nothing there. He said, oh no, there's a whole lot going on between the two of us. There's all kinds of energy here. Everything is energy, and everything is connected. And he went on to explain how, if I look at my body in the same way, everything being connected, you know, there's all, not just connective tissue, but channels of energy, the streams of energy that are going through me. If I look at that as a streams connecting to rivers, connecting to lakes, and everything affecting everything, this is the way to health. He was explaining to me how back in the, almost a century ago now, he followed this healer around as an assistant. And this healer was an energy healer. And he thought, oh, that's just a bunch of bunk. But he saw what she was doing for people, and he was mesmerized. And here he was living with his brother. They were both bachelors in this little farm back in the North Woods here. And hardly anybody knew about him, and I didn't know why, because he had this beautiful awareness as to how we function. He didn't talk at all about muscles and nerves and bones and sinew and guts and brains. He talked about this synchronous organism, and just a beautiful vision that he gave me about how we are. And I've never looked at a living being in the same way since then. And then he started talking about the world around. He said, that's not a tree, this isn't the ground, that's not a bird. This is all part of a greater organism, this flowing energy. And when we see ourselves that way, and what we're talking about, you know, when we exercise with the artificially constructed exercises, you know, we're trying to design something for a particular muscle system or a particular reason. And that is completely denying who we are from this man's perspective. What we're doing now is getting back to that, moving as a being within the greater being, moving synchronously, moving in rhythm with the greater rhythms. That's really what we're doing now. This is how we become invisible. We can walk by things all the time, we don't see them, they don't stand out because they belong, they just fit here. We might see them, but we're not really looking at them, so that's as good as invisibility. Just belong. And we can just belong too. That's where we're going.